Hi, this is Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. And in our ongoing series on Nobel Prize winners, tonight we're going to talk about Riccardo Giacconi, who died recently at the age of 87. Dr. Giacconi was awarded one half of the Nobel Prize in Physics in 2002. The other half was divided one quarter each to Raymond Davis Jr. and Masatoshi Koshiba. And according to NobelPrize.org, Dr. Giacconi was awarded the Nobel Prize for pioneering contributions to astrophysics, which have led to the discovery of cosmic X-ray sources. A further explanation of his work is that stars and galaxies emit not only visible light, but also X-rays. However, the X-rays dissipate as they pass through the Earth's atmosphere, so X-rays from the cosmos have to be studied by means of telescopes and satellites. Beginning in the 1960s, Riccardo Giacconi made several pivotal contributions to the development of such telescopes. With the telescopes, he discovered X-ray sources outside our own solar system, cosmic background radiation with X-ray wavelengths, as well as X-ray sources that probably contain black holes. I'd love to be able to explain this to you better in layman's terms, but it is physics, and you know how I am with physics, not very good. Then combine that with the fact that this is astrophysics, and I'm really lost. So I'll just borrow from the New York Times obit here. Dr. Giacconi was one of the great captains of big science, leaving lasting imprints on major astronomical institutions like the Space Telescope Science Institute in Baltimore, which runs the Hubble Space Telescope, and the European Southern Observatory in Germany, where he oversaw the building of the largest telescope on Earth. He helped set the pattern for how large scientific projects are run today. Here is the presentation of the 2002 Nobel Prize in Physics to Dr. Giacconi and his two co-laureates.
Professor Davis and Koshiba, Professor Giacconi, your groundbreaking research has opened new windows on the universe. You have conducted your experiments underground in deep mines or at high altitudes using satellites and rockets to escape the Earth's atmosphere. We are now all together at sea level, and on behalf of the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences, I wish to congratulate you for your outstanding work. And I now ask you to step forward to receive the Nobel Prize in Physics from the hands of His Majesty the King.
And Dr. Riccardo Giacconi.
Dr. Giacconi was a nice Italian boy born in Genoa, but he grew up in Milan. He got his PhD in physics at the University of Milan, spent a couple years there. In fact, he gravitated towards scientific discipline at the base of the Matterhorn.
I did my thesis work at the foot of the Matterhorn. There was a hut where we're doing cosmic ray research at 3,500 meters. It was interesting and long. I spent 2 years up there. These cosmic ray particles are very rare, so I started thinking about how could I possibly concentrate them on my detector so that I could get on with my thesis work and finish it.
He moved to the United States, spent a little time at Indiana University, then moved to Princeton for a while, before moving to Cambridge, Massachusetts, where he worked at American Science and Engineering, a small company that carried out research for NASA and other organizations. That's where he did much of the work that led to the Nobel Prize.
I believe that the committee chose the work that I had done in X-ray astronomy. I started very early on in the space physics program. This was 59, which was reasonably early. I was given the opportunity to fly rockets to look for X-ray stars, which were not known to exist. And the luck comes in finding the first one. The reason why it was lucky was that it was extremely interesting, and that was different from anything which had been thought to be there. And so it was lucky because it was 1,000 times more brighter in X-rays than the sun at all wavelength. And also it emitted more X-rays by 1,000-fold than visible light, which is not what happens on Earth when you take an X-ray machine. Most of the energy goes in heat. But this star was the most efficient X-ray. So a new class of objects and a new physical processes.
So a new class of objects and a new physical process that radically changed all of astrophysics and it led to new telescopes, such as the Hubble. Here he talks about the new astrophysics and the new telescopes.
What I brought to the space telescope was a point of view which was useful, which I had gained in X-ray astronomy until then. And that was that to be an X-ray astronomer, you had to explain what you were doing to a number of astronomers who knew nothing about X-rays or didn't know how to analyze the data, calibrate the data, and so forth. So we applied the methodology that we had developed to make this data understandable to other astronomers to the space telescope. And of course, everybody thought that they knew how to analyze data in the optical domain and UV domain. But the fact of the matter is the space telescope produced data at an enormous rate. And so we had to change how we looked at the data from Hubble and make it very, very fast. We analyzed the data in real time. We calibrated the data for the viewer. And then we put them in huge archives so that, first of all, the observer would get it, but then within a year, the whole world would get it. And this created a big difference then in the way people perceived astronomy, the educational impact of what was going on, the research, the productivity, and so forth.
You know, cosmic X-rays and space telescopes are not exactly what we'd call practical research. And on top of that, all this stuff costs a lot of money. But Dr. Giacconi defends it in an interesting way. He takes from his Italian-European tradition. And I think it's the first time I've heard this, but it's fascinating.
First of all, it's very important that we understand that even when they are in space, the money for these telescopes is spent on the ground. It's spent to pay for engineers, scientists, students to learn, and so forth. So there is a tremendous technological return from all of this. The second thing is I don't think we need to justify it on the basis of practical result. I mean, after all, not only of bread liveth man. And I think these are the new cathedrals we are building in the modern age. I call them the cathedrals of the mind. So you could ask, well, what was the point of building? Okay, I will use the following example. The amount of effort to build Hubble is the same as the amount of effort to build an average cathedral. That one took 100 people, 100 years, and this one took 1,000 people, 10 years. It turns out the product, the many years, is the same. So the cost of cathedral and these things is the same. And you can ask the same questions in both cases.
Well, in these profiles of Nobel Prize winners, if possible, I'd like to get their perspective on what made them successful. And oftentimes, you hear the same theme of persistence, not giving up. Dr. Giacconi gives an interesting perspective on that, and he also offers what he feels may be the biggest obstacle to young scientists, which is the censure of your peer community.
In my case, when I started off, I tried to convince the National Aeronautics and Space Administration that I wanted to go look at stars in X-rays, and they thought this would not be interesting, so then I had to go to the Air Force and asked if they could be interested in this, and they at the time were interested in studying the moon, perhaps. And so that's why my proposal emphasized the moon, because this was interesting for a sponsor. But basically, I was doing what I wanted to do. And then misfortune, criticism, and so forth. Well, you internalize a lot of this, but basically, you're doing what you want. And that's a fantastic reward, I mean, to be able to be allowed to do in life what you want to do. So it's very difficult to deflect you and adversities and so forth. Well, I mean, maybe one could give up, but it never occurred to me that I would. And so the adversity was just something that, particularly in a space program, you have to become accustomed to the fact that there may be failure. And so do you stop? Not at all. You go on, you try to figure out a better way, you try to figure out some way to put in more disaster-proof approaches and so on. But I haven't heard anybody really involved that would quit. What makes people quit, I think, is when they absolutely cannot convince their peers that what they want to do is rational. And therefore, they find great difficulties in getting support because of peer review system and so forth, particularly in the United States. Since, you know, we are people sensitive, just like anybody else, you tend to internalize that as a self-criticism. Maybe I don't know what I'm doing. And at that point, you're lost.
Here, Dr. Giacconi talks about the new relationship between astronomy and physics, and he alludes to Brahe and Kepler, the world's greatest astronomer centuries ago. And then he shifts to Einstein.
It was a wonderful period where Tycho and Kepler lived, because it's a transition between magic and science, and we're both still involved. Let me think a moment of Kepler. Kepler, the astronomer, the following problem, that he was thinking about the motion of the planets. He was very careful in interpreting Tycho Brahe data, and he tried to express regular laws. However, there was a fundamental problem in his mind, which was the following. It wasn't obvious how the planets would actually be dragged in the sky according to these laws. So what was the actual mechanism? Well, there was an Italian scientist, not quite as famous, who had solved the problem by saying that the planets were inhabited by living beings who would fly like swans flying around the sun in formation. Kepler didn't accept that at all, thank God. However, he had no idea of gravitational laws. And so for him to say that there was a law at distance whereby the sun could influence the motion of the planet was like magic, was worse magic than what he suggested, which was that there would be magnetic brooms pushing the planets along in their orbit. At least it was a physical explanation. Now, the jump of going to that, from that, to actually recognizing the physical laws that regulate this motion, to me, is a creative jump. I think that astronomy there led physics, in the sense that you couldn't think about gravity and so forth, and explaining the orbits of the planets without the data from Tycho and then as interpreted by Kepler. Right now, we provide evidence for some of the most extraordinary form of matter. We need another Einstein or another Newton, I mean, to figure out a unified theory of everything. But in that sense, we are moving in. So when you say, well, was it predicted? Well, Einstein thought about the cosmological constant, but it's not obvious that it's a constant. It's dark energy, so it's going to be very interesting to find out whether it is or it isn't. So I think that we are in a unique position as astronomy was 500 years ago.
You want to feel insignificant? Well, if you don't take away anything else from this podcast, take away that according to Dr. Giacconi, 97% of the universe is made up of things we know nothing about.
Of the baryon mass, only a small fraction is in normal matter at normal temperature. We know that 10 times that is like very hot gas. Then we know that 10 times that is in dark matter, of which we have no idea about at all. And then twice that, roughly speaking, is dark energy. So to make it fast, is 97% of the universe is in forms of matter which we know nothing about. So that's what, and that's important for elementary particle physics as well.
Well, I'm going to close on that note. I want to thank my producer and IT genius, Sid Tepps. Dr. Giacconi is going to make it easy for me tonight to pick out the tribute song. Although he lived in America for many, many years, he was still an Italian at heart. And here he talks about his favorite city in the world.
My favorite city in the world is Rome, because every place you walk, you have a discovery, right? And something totally unexpected. You look down there, and there is an excavation going down to 30 feet through the old Trajan wall and all that. You have a feeling of continuity.
Let's see. Rome, a famous site, and maybe an Italian singer. I think we can do that. Here's our final tribute to Dr. Roberto Giacconi.
Three coins in the fountain, three hearts in the fountain, each heart longing for its home. There they lie in the fountain, somewhere.